So tonight, Andre will both read for us and be interviewed by Dick Lear. Dick is a professor of journalism at Boston University. His new book, The Birth of a Nation, How a Legendary Director and Crusading Editor Reignited America's Civil War, is due out in November. He's the author of Fence, a Boston Globe bestseller, and co-author of the New York Times bestseller Black Mass, Whitey Bulger, the FBI, and A Devil's Deal, which has just finished shooting in Boston, I believe, as a movie. He's also the author of the sequel to the book, Whitey, The Life of America's Most Notorious Mob Boss. And he was in the book festival last year in 2013 with that book. While at the Boston Globe, he won numerous national and regional journalism awards and was a Pulitzer Prize finalist in investigative reporting. And best of all, he lives just up the road in Aquinnah. So let me turn it over to Dick and to Andre. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Sue Ellen. As a journalist, I've certainly interviewed plenty of folks over the years from all walks of life, and they include heads of state, gangsters, judges, leaders of the Ku Klux Klan, politicians, and so on. But this is a real treat tonight, to be able to sit up here to introduce and talk to a writer whose work I so greatly admire. I met Andre when he was here talking about Towney at the book festival in 2011, and I'm sure some of you in the audience were here for that event, and you already know he's terrific. If you don't know, Andre is the author of 6 books, including the New York Times bestseller at number 1, House of Sand and Fog, which in addition to being a National Book Award finalist was made into a film starring Ben Kingsley and Jennifer Connelly. And also his 2011 memoir, Towney, was also a New York Times bestseller and a Times Editor's Choice for all books that year. Tonight, Andre is going to discuss his latest book, Dirty Love, a collection of 4 novellas with some overlapping characters and stories that are mainly connected and that each involves someone looking for love, or as one reviewer has noted, disoriented by love. Dirty Love was selected by both the Washington Post and New York Times as one of its notable books of the year. Kirkus Reviews named it a starred best book of 2013. And among the comments that reviewers have made, they include what Washington Post Ron Charles wrote about Andre, that he writes in a transparent, easy style that's never self-consciously lyrical, but constantly delivers phrases of insight and gentle wit that lay open these characters without scalding them. And I have to give you a quick example. I really do. I mean, because in one of the stories, the first story, involving a character named Mark Welch, who discovers his wife of many years has been cheating on him. And at the moment of that discovery, Andre describes, quote, his heart kicking like a hangman's feet. 8 words, and there it is. It's all there. Okay, that's what this reviewer is talking about. The New York Times' Jeff Turpentine added high praise for Andre's ability to write, quote, no-nonsense prose, artful and straightforward. His sentences are like windows of tempered glass. They seem sturdier and more transparent than so many others out there. His sentences know exactly what their job is, to perform it with consummate grace and quiet pride. So we're all going to, the format for tonight is Andre's going to read an excerpt for about 10 or 15 minutes. Then we're going to sit and I'll get to ask him some questions. And then we're going to turn it over to you. And hopefully you'll have plenty to ask him as well. And then he'll stick around to sign some books. So with that, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Andre Dubuc III.
Thank you, Dick. And you all, thank you for being here. You know, Sue Ellen's nice son, Evan, just drove me here from my inn, and I admitted to him something that I have to tell you, because it's just shocking. When I didn't know that Martha's Vineyard was an island until I was 35. I grew up north of Boston, one of these North Shore kids, never went to the Cape, and actually, I think it was one of my students at Tufts said, you know, he's going to go to Martha's Vineyard for the summer, and he's talking about the ferry. I said, what, you got to take a boat to get to a Martha. I thought that was on the Cape. Anyway, just like, it's my third time back, and I'm glad to be here, is what I'm telling you. I'm just going to read, I'm going to read maybe like 11 minutes tops, and let's have a conversation. And it's an honor to be up here with Dick Lear, by the way. I'm very happy for, I'm very happy that book's getting made into a film directed by Scott Cooper and starring Johnny Depp, and it's going to make Whitey Bulger look like the son of a bitch he is, so there you go. I'm going to read from the second story in the collection. It's called Marla. I think all you need to know is that she's one of these not so rare people who have fallen through the cracks and not found love, and she's pushing 30, and she still hasn't even had sex. And she's physically large, pretty, solitary, socially awkward, and then she finally meets a man, and they very quickly begin to live together. And she's really happy because she's now Marla, she's part of a couple. She's not just Marla, she's now part of Marla and Dennis. He's also physically large, he's a radio frequency engineer. They moved in together pretty quickly, and she's starting to learn that living with a man ain't all might be cracked up to be. At home, as 1 week pushed into another, little things about Dennis began to bother Marla. The sometimes nasal way he'd call her Marl, how at breakfast every morning he'd skip the newspaper headlines and do the crossword puzzle instead, how he cleaned up so often the place never looked lived in. Even their lovemaking needed something. It always seemed to stop just as things began to gather all warm and rising for her, and she didn't like how he always took a shower after. It made her feel dirty and like what they'd done was slightly wrong somehow. He stopped wanting to go anywhere except on weekends, preferred instead to watch TV or go to his computer room and play games where the viewer entered a cyber world armed with a shotgun, machete, and hand grenades. He taught her how to play it too, but sitting in that dark room, staring at the simulated colors of bad muscular men bleeding to death from just a click of the mouse on Dennis's desk, from the electronic blast of the shotgun or the swipe of the machete blade, Marla felt the same bruised emptiness that she did after an action movie, and she'd kiss Dennis on the forehead and leave the room while he kept playing. There was something else, too, and she hated herself for this, but it was his weight. Watching him walk naked into or out of the bathroom, she often looked away, not out of respect for his privacy, but because honestly, she did not like to see the way his hairy chest pushed out to the side like a woman's, how his belly hung almost to his penis, which looked somehow boyish and outmatched in the great mass of all that flesh and hair. At first, she thought this reflected his size and strength, his very manliness. But that's when she allowed herself to think he'd been a wrestler or weightlifter in college, maybe even a football player, not the sedentary man she now knew him to be and to always have been. He told her that he spent his childhood in his room reading and drawing robots and guns and galactic cities floating in fiery orbits, that college was one long period of book after book and a lot of hamburgers, pizza, and fries. She found herself judging him for this, especially at night after dinner, dessert too, when he'd bring a box of crackers and a jar of peanut butter to living room with him, or a second helping of dessert, or a hunk of cheese and bowl of nuts. One night in late November, a couple of days after a Thanksgiving they'd spent at a restaurant, she had a cold and sat on the couch wrapped in a blanket, holding a hot cup of lemon tea. She glanced at the peanut butter crackers on his plate and said, "You really hungry?" He just sat down. He looked over at her, his cheeks flushed. Obviously. Marla didn't know if he was angry or embarrassed, and she felt mean-spirited and small. For a long minute or two, there was nothing but the sounds of the TV, the forced laughter of the studio audience, slender actors with good skin and shiny hair looking naturally appealing. "You shouldn't talk, you know." Dennis bit off half a cracker and chewed. "What? You know what I mean." Marla's face burned. It was as if he just overturned the couch and she was falling to the floor. "You're talking about my weight?" Dennis swallowed and bit into another cracker, his eyes on the television. There were crumbs in his beard, and she hated him for it. And they began to blur, and she jumped off the couch and rushed upstairs to their room. His room, really. His bed and his bureau and bedside table. On the walls were framed his degrees and another boring graphic. On their bureau were his wallet and keys. Where was her room? She curled up on the bed and cried. She could hear the jingle of a commercial downstairs, and she wondered how long he'd stay down there without coming up to address what had just happened between them. And what did happen? She was mean, and then so was he. But it was more than just that. Marla couldn't help but notice that part of her was relieved to see another ugly side of him. The TV noise stopped, and she heard the creak of the carpeted stairs, then the sinking of the bed, the smell of peanut butter and his perfumey cologne. "Marl?" "Yeah?" She sniffled, dabbed at her nose with two fingers. "You think I'm too heavy? Do you think I am?" "No." "Then why'd you say what you said?" "To get back at you, I guess." Marla sat up and blew her nose. He rested his hand on her thigh, and she knew they were on their way to patching this up, but something had opened between them, and she wasn't sure she wanted it closed. She looked straight ahead at the dark window. "I've always been fat, you know." "Me too." Marla wiped her nose. "But I bet you had girlfriends." "Two or three, nobody special." "Well, I didn't." Marla kept her eyes on the black glass of the window, the reflection of a lampshade in it. "You're my first boyfriend."
"I am?"
"Yes."
"Oh."
He nodded his head. She wished she hadn't told him, but was also glad she did, as if this were some kind of test they could not avoid, though she did not know who was testing whom. "Are you surprised?"
"No.
I mean, yeah, of course I am. What's that have to do with anything?" Marla shrugged. "I'm not the best catch in the world, Dennis." "Marla." "No, really. I'm not pretty. All I know how to do is count other people's money." Stop that, Marla. You shouldn't say that." His voice was gentle but distant, too, like he was already beginning to believe what she was saying and didn't want to. He pulled his hand from her thigh and stared at the floor again.
"You should never say that about yourself."
They sat quietly for a moment. Then he stood and took a long, tired breath. "Want me to bring your tea up?" She shook her head and listened to him walk heavily out of the room and down the stairs. Later, in the middle of the night, she woke up with him pushing himself inside her, and he did it harder and faster than ever before. It hurt a little, but then felt good and lasted longer, too. He finally stopped and let out a moan, said into her ear, breathing hard, "I'm sorry, I was asleep."
"Me too."
He went to the bathroom first, they usually wear condoms, and Marla lay there in the dark. She patted the bedside table for the box of tissues, Dennis's seed swimming freely inside of her. What if it found what it was heading for? She heard the shower turn on, the jerk of the curtain, Dennis washing himself off. That night, she dreamed she was sitting in a rocking chair on a screened-in porch overlooking deep woods, sunlight coming through in brilliant patches. There was something warm and soft in her lap, a puppy, she thought. She looked down at it and saw a baby with fine black hair and a sweet, pinched face. The next day was Sunday, and on the way home from the matinee of a spy movie she hadn't wanted to see, she told Dennis her dream. She studied his profile as he drove, the way he nodded slightly, his eyes narrowed as if he were listening to the radio report of news in a distant country. She took a breath. "Think we'll ever have a baby, Denny?"
"Not if I can help it."
Marla felt slapped. She looked out the window at large houses, one with raked piles of leaves, a swing set in the yard. She felt like crying, not because of what he'd said, but how he'd said it, his voice adamant and final. Then his big hand was on her knee, and she wanted to push it away. "You know I love you, Marl, but do you know how much kids cost? How much attention they need? It's nothing personal, hon. I just can't be bothered with that."
"Bothered? You make it sound like one big nuisance."
"Well, isn't it? Did your mother think so?" He smiled. "I know she did."
Then he chuckled and began to reminisce about him and his brothers always destroying the house, chasing each other from room to room. He seemed to be done with the real conversation, but it had cleared a cold, dead path through her head. It was the first time he'd ever told her he loved her, but hearing him talk this way about what she had always viewed as the highest gift God could give, his paw resting too heavily on her thigh, the sickening smell of vanilla air freshener in his car, another Sunday afternoon wasted at a movie where men shot or impaled or blew up each other, she began to suspect she was nothing more than an easy addition to his life. One he could penetrate half asleep or go out with on the weekend, but that's it. No one to start a family with, nothing like that. Her seatbelt was pushing into her hip, and she began to feel the possibility of an end ahead of them, the way the light of an August afternoon could sometimes cast the shadows of October. I'll just one more page here. The week before Christmas, Dennis invited her to fly to Cleveland to spend the holidays with one of his brothers and his family. He asked her this before work as they were walking to their cars in the cleared driveway Dennis paid a man to plow. The air was cold in Marla's lungs and her breath was a thin cloud in front of her. "What do you say, Marl?" She opened her car door and glanced over at him standing at his Nissan, his tie loosely knotted beneath his overcoat, his beard glistening in the harsh sunlight. "I don't think so. I need to visit my parents. It's been a year." He nodded and looked only mildly disappointed, as if he were imagining the good times ahead of him anyway. "Well, think about it." He backed out of the driveway first and at the end of the street waved in his rearview mirror at her before he turned left and she turned right, and she didn't want to think about it. How could she be the woman he was going to bring home to his family? All the smiles and gifts and polite passings of gravy would feel like one big lie, which is what she was beginning to feel like, a liar. Somehow she was becoming the kind of woman she didn't like, somebody who felt one way but smiled it off in a mask of cheerfulness, the kind of woman who got very good at small talk. As she drove past all the identical ranch houses of their neighborhood, Marla's face still felt swollen from her cold. If it weren't for the Christmas rush, everybody in the world waiting in line to get their money, she'd call in sick and go back to bed, but again, it'd be his bed. Her comforter was on it, but that wasn't enough. She missed her old apartment. She missed the bathroom that only had her things in it. She missed her cat, Edna, curling up with her on the sofa in her living room with her framed prints on the wall and no illustrations of perfect parallel lines, no dustless bookshelves full of paperback spy novels, no pressure to keep things clean and just where they belong at all times. And not this lingering feeling that her life was really no better than it had been before when she was alone. An earlier unhappiness that now seemed preferable to this one. Thank you.
That was great. Thanks.
Thank you.
So that was Marla. He gave us a...
That was Marla. Is this on? Is it? There it is.
All right, good.
Thank you.
Yes. He gave us a glimpse of Marla, and it's one of four stories that really work this soil of love. So I think I'm going to start where I usually start when interviewing someone, and it's at the beginning, which is tell us about the genesis of Dirty Love as a book. How, where you got the idea, how you got started, when did you see that you had four stories that were connected? In the way that they are.
I'm just going to hold it like a talk show host.
Okay. Such a time.
I'll take control of this damn microphone. Thank you. Well, you know, and I know there are other writers in this room, and they may agree, and I'd be curious what you would answer to this. I don't think I'm exaggerating when I say that about 95% of whatever I've published really are the phoenixes that have risen from the ashes of what's failed. So Marla came from, well, let me tell you how they came. For years, I mean, maybe like 9 years of writing, I tried to write about a certain kind of con man. No, not 9 years, not that long, but for a good chunk of time. And you've read about this kind of criminal in the paper, and I have too, and it's always been a novel idea I've been knocking around. And in three separate times, I tried to write it. And I would spend weeks and months. The first time I was about 3 months in, I'd done all this research into all sorts of ways to steal from other people. And then I went to back in time to find out where he grew up. And what came was this rogue bartender who was lying to himself and others and cheating on his wife and screwing waitresses.
Right.
And he's a real creep. Yeah. I thought, okay, so his father's a creep. That's interesting. But something horrible happened, which is so common. Within a paragraph or two of writing from the point of view of this guy, Robert, he was 10 times more real and alive than this con man.
That you'd been working so
hard. Yeah, that I've been working so hard on.
Yeah.
And that, and so I've been teaching writing a long time, and it took me about 10 years of teaching writing classes before I finally heard myself saying this. I think that there's a difference between making it up on one hand and imagining it on the other. That just because you want to write about a con man, just because I want to write about a con man, doesn't mean he wants to be written about by me. You know, it's like those families I have a good friend who's a very masculine athlete, and he was in high school and in college, and his son's an effeminate gay boy. Mm-hmm. And it was just hell to watch dad try to make his son a masculine athlete. His son's not going to be him, ever. And I bring it up because it feels the same way, to try to make your character be the way you want it to be. So I let go of the con man, and I just wrote this story, and it was the bartender. And I published it in 1999. It's about 50 pages long. I wrote another novel. 3 years later, or longer, maybe 6 years later, I started the con man novel again. Hmm. Now, go back about 30 years now. 30 years later, earlier, my sister lived in Miami. We're in our early 30s, early 20s. It's the 80s. And I'm visiting her, and it's summertime in Miami. It is hot, and I'm just trying to get across that baking hot parking lot into the air-conditioned bank to say hi to my big sister. And, it's the 80s in Miami, so Don Johnson's driving around with no socks, and there's cocaine and the actual palm fronds. And I glanced, I don't exaggerate, I think half a second to 1 second, I glanced at the drive-through window because it was this sort of all-glass tinted window, air conditioned, and one woman was working there. She was large, pretty, and so solitary. I think I looked at her for 1 second. 26 years later, she shows up under my Ticonderoga number 2 pencil as my con man's first victim. And I go into her point of view just to get to know her a little bit before I zap her with my con man.
Right.
And within a paragraph, she's 10 times more alive than he was.
So it's like the bartender.
So then that became Marla. And I didn't even want to write about it. I didn't want to write about Marla. I wanted to go to my sexy con man novel. But I've learned over the years, and I'm getting hot, so I'm going to take this off. I've learned over the years to just, you got to let it happen.
Yeah.
And then the other two came in the last 2 or 3 years.
Okay. Where's the con man now?
The con man, screw him. I'm not calling him anymore. Although a friend of mine who's a writer said, you should keep him. He keeps leading you to stories.
I wonder if there's a point of intersection between, your work as a fiction writer and then nonfiction writers when you talk about you had to go with the bartender. He was more interesting, even though then it was Marla. And it made me think of a line I once heard that Tracy Kidder said when he was writing a nonfiction book about Northampton. I think it's called Hometown. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was asked, of all the people, he focused the main character in that is a local cop, a beat cop. And a lot of people who knew that community couldn't believe he chose him as his main character, as the most interesting character, the bartender or Marla, the equivalent. And they were saying, why didn't you do the mayor? Because he's so colorful and charismatic and crazy and this and that. And from a nonfiction perspective, reporting on the real world and whatnot, he said, you have to go where the light is. And the mayor wouldn't give me any time.
Nice.
And I had to go with the cop. The cop opened up his life to me and stuff like that. And I wonder if there's some kind of similarity there. I mean, your con man was not working for you.
I love that line from Kidder. There's a beautiful line from Willa Cather, the American novelist. She said, a writer is at her best only when writing within the character and range of her deepest sympathies, which is really beautiful. I mean, it's not helpful after you've done it, but I mean, it's helpful after you've written something, but not before. I mean, I think what she's really saying is you have to care about what you're working on. And, you know, Faulkner has that really famous answer about, he was asked late in his life, what's the main thing that a writer needs to even have a shot of creating the kind of work you have, Mr. Faulkner? And he said, well, it ain't talent. He said, I used to think it was talent, but I don't anymore. Do you know what the famous answer was? Curiosity. And his exact phrase was curiosity, insight, to wonder, to mull and to muse why it is that man does what he does. And if you have that, talent makes no difference whether you've got it or not. And I guess what I'm getting at is, when I look back at the bartender and then Marla and then the characters and the other two novellas in this book, you can't choose what you're curious about. Mm-hmm. The same way you can't choose who you're going to... How many of you have ever tried to fall in love with someone in particular? How'd that go for you? Right? You can't. You either fall in love with someone or you don't. And this, so what I'm getting at is, there's one thing I love, I think the central thing I love about writing, and I'm sure you would identify as a nonfiction writer, is it's an act of excavation, and you never know what you're going to find. And what often comes to me as a surprise is what it is that I'm really curious about. When I look at Marla, I have a lot of women and a few men in my life who've fallen through the cracks and didn't get married and didn't have kids, and I think I've always been pulled to wondering what that's like.
Yeah. Okay. You know? So you had Marla and you had the bartender, then. But I'm really curious in the last couple of years, like, where did you see them becoming part of Dirty Love? And the longest novella is the title story, Dirty Love.
Yeah.
And including Mark Welch, the with the eight words that I drew from the first story. Mm. That you sat down and said, I can put this together. This is going to work as some kind of organic whole.
Well, you know, I think writers, so I tend to write long form instead of short, so in novels seem to come out of me more than short stories. My dad, as you probably know, was a short story master, but I go on, and so I had finished my novel, The Garden Last Days, then I finished my memoir, Townie, yeah. And so this is, I'm just, don't tell my friend, this is between us, right? I know you're filming it, just don't go show it off this island we're on. A good friend of mine, this is where, you know, writers are horrible vultures and thieves and bad people, had a horrible divorce where he began to feel, you know, he married his wife for 25 years. We thought they were really one of the good couples. It's always the couple you think will never break up. And he's starting to get weird feelings, so he hires a detective because that's the kind of guy my buddy is. And the detective gives him just what he didn't want, but I think did want to find out. And between us, he didn't leave her. She kept the affair going with this guy. The kids are grown. He had built an in-law apartment for his mother. So she's living in an apartment attached to the house. He is sleeping on the couch in his mother's apartment, while his wife, who's still cheating on him, is living in the big house, sleeping in their now big, half-empty master bed. And the three adults, they're in their 50s, she's in her 80s, are living together. And I'm thinking, what the hell is that like? Oh my God, do they have conversations in the driveway in the morning? Or are they ever in the pool in the back at the same time? And again, you can't choose what you're interested in. So this is, that story is not my friend and his wife at all, but I stole that tableau and just went into it. Again, though, with curiosity, what would it be like if you're waking up hungover a lot on your mother's couch and next door is your cheating wife who you still love? And so that became the second.
And how do you, yeah. Okay, I know, maybe some of you have read that story. I have, and that main character is not a writer, but a project manager for a software company.
Yeah.
And one of the things that's so powerful about it is that he realizes his response to this, you know, marital disaster that he's confronting is as if it's a problem at work with one of his, you know, software programs and projects with, yeah, his employee, you know, the workers for him, and he's kind of. He knows no other way anymore because he's been doing that for so long. How did you go there? What are you doing?
Well, you know, I mean, and this is where I think fiction writers and nonfiction writers are a lot alike. And you know, I'm not a lover of the digital world. I don't have a gadget. I've never texted. I'm never going to. I'm never going to have a screen in my hand. I think it's making us all, it's putting us all in a trance, and it's a retreat from the world. Forgive me, I'm on my soapbox. But that said, I love my Google, and I use it every damn day. And because very quickly, especially if you're writing novels, you're going to write yourself into areas about which you're totally ignorant. And so I'm imagining, so I'm stepping into this man's life, and I'm just trying to be him, and imagine if it's my wife who's now on this side of that wall, and my mother, and that beautiful act of sustained empathy that fiction writing is. And I didn't want to make him something I know, which is being a writer or a professor or a carpenter or a bartender, things that I've been. So a friend of mine is a project manager at a very big company in Seattle, and I've always been fascinated by his job because it seems like a shitload of responsibility. Pardon my French, I know we're being filmed. And so I interviewed him for about 3 hours over a brunch. Mm-hmm. And what are your skills? And then I tried to bring that into my psyche. Okay, this is now the kind of guy I am. And that's what I love about writing. Before I knew it, it was in the writing that I discovered, oh, you know, I mean, the big thing that project managers do is manage risk. And so I realized, well, this is actually a really controlling guy. And then I thought about my own life. You know, we all bring, you know, I saw a conference once where a writer, he was a fantasy writer, he said to a question, he said, oh, I always give my characters their jobs last. I think, last? What are you talking about, last? That's, I can have that first. My God, I was a construction worker for years. I would come home from work. I seriously was so exhausted from thinking geometrically and using my body, I needed the remote and a beer, and I grunted. I'd come home from teaching, I'd be talking too much. Honey, and then another thing, right? So Nisha, right? Then this one girl, she raises her hand, and I said, you know, and then I come home from when I was a bounty hunter of all things, locking the windows. And so I was a bounty hunter for 6 months. That's a whole other story. And so... So I discovered it in the writing, and that's the fun of it for me. That's just the joy of it.
Yeah, okay.
But I realized that he was controlling the hell out of his marriage, and that maybe she had some reasons for straying from the lad. They weren't all bad.
Okay, so questions about the process for you, which we're getting at a little bit in that, in terms of you did some reporting, and you started to blend that into your character, and then you realize how it really, you know, what you just described. But, and this is some of it, I mean, again, the curiosity of another writer, but also I think people in general is like, where do you write? And when do you write? Are you a morning writer? Are you a midnight writer?
I wonder, when are you though? I'm curious when you write.
I'm a morning writer.
Me too. Now, why do you prefer to write in the morning?
I feel fresh.
Yeah.
That's when I'm most focused and intense.
You know, I don't know if I'm freshest then, actually. I think I feel freshest right around, you know, noontime. But I do write first thing in the morning, ideally, 5-6 days a week. Edna O'Brien, the beautiful Irish short story writer, beautiful in every way, she said, you know, I prefer to write in the morning, she said, because I like to go from the dream world to the dream world. You know, before all the crap that's in your head, the errands and the to-do list. And so I've found over the years that I prefer it. So I built my house with my hands. I was just telling Eben about it. It was a joyous damn experience, and it took about 3 years to build this house. And I built an in-law apartment for my wife's parents. Oh, shit, we have an in-law apartment. Not good. And I, you know, it's a big house, and it was a joy to build for my wife, 3 kids, and my in-laws, and our dog. And I forgot to build a writing room. Just never, oh, geez, I didn't build a room to write in. But then I noticed that in the basement I had some really tall ceilings. So I built this soundproof cave in my basement. My friend said it's like an ant farm because you have to go down in the basement and up these stairs to this room I built, which is very small. It's like 5 feet wide, a 6-foot ceiling, 11 feet long, a little window I cover with a blanket. I write in front of a blank wall with, I've changed pencils to another brand, Composition Mead notebooks with headphones on. And I'm just down there, you know, 2 to 4 hours.
Headphone music.
No, silence.
Silence.
From my table saw. So it's just total silence down there.
And you'd write longhand, right, if I remember correctly?
I do. Do you?
No.
Oh, you're a reporter.
Yeah. You got to be fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. No, that's amazing. And even stepping back a little further in terms of this writing process is, this is a really big question, but broad in the sense, is like, where do you get your ideas? And do you ever get frightened about not having an idea?
That's a good question. I've never been asked that about not having an idea. No, I think this whole notion of writer's block, I don't think people are staring because they have nothing to write. I think we all of us have too much to write, especially the older we get. We're bottlenecked with experiences. And my ideas tend to be very fragmented and slivered. And the smaller the idea, the better. But so, for example, and sometimes they come in really strange ways. For example, in Dirty Love, the longest one, so I sent these three novellas. How many of you have read any of the novellas of Jim Harrison, the beautiful writer from Michigan? Yeah, beautiful, right? And he excels in the novella form. He's published, I don't know, maybe a dozen collections of novellas, three each. And I thought, I think I might have a Harrison like, and not as good, but I've got three novellas. I'll do that. So I sent it to my editor, and she said some nice things. She said, but I don't know. It feels like it needs one more. And as soon as she said that, I mean, it hurt my feelings like 5 seconds. And then I thought, well, I began to see, or no, I didn't even see them. I began to sense an old man and a young girl. And I knew they lived together, and they loved each other, but it wasn't creepy. That they were related, and it was a healthy, beautiful thing. And I could just sense they were on the coast somewhere north of Boston. And I began to write, and what came was the 81-year-old point of view of Frances Brandt, who is a recovering alcoholic, newly widowed after 43 years of marriage, former school teacher, and his 18-year-old great niece is living with him, fleeing a pornographic film of her online and some other crap at home. And I just kept writing. But it began with just almost like a dream. You could just, you dream about a white dog on a porch and you just go with it.
But okay, your editor says it feels like it needs one more. I mean, have you ever thought about how that happened, though? From, it wasn't like she even gave you anything to go on or
no, I have no idea.
Why you went to this,
Well, but she also pointed out, it was my editor who said, do you realize after I'd written that one, which took about a little over a year, she said, do you know that these people are in the same two towns, and two of them are working in the same bank, and two of them working in the same restaurant? So I didn't notice that.
Now, did you know that you had some of the same characters, like Charlie Brandt?
I
very minor.
I did, but she pointed out, it was really more unconscious than conscious. What I'm getting at is, and I talk about this more than I probably should, there's a beautiful line from Richard Bausch, the wonderful fiction writer, who said, if you think that you're thinking when you're writing, think again. You're much closer.
Say that again.
He said, if you think that you are thinking when you're writing, think again. He said, you're much closer to the dreaming side of your mind. So dream, dream, dream it through. And I found that it's always gone better for me creatively when I have gone in with no agenda, none, when I've been trying not to say a damn thing, where I've really gone into it with that authentic Faulknerian curiosity, where I am genuinely curious. Mm-hmm. Wow, what's it like to be these two people in this situation? So lots of times, my novel Garden Last Days, there's a line from Flannery O'Connor. She says, there's a certain grain of stupidity the writer can hardly do without. And that is the quality of having to stare. And I was staring at my notebook, getting ready to start a new story, and I just saw cash on a bedroom bureau. And so I began to describe it, learning over the years to just trust what comes. And I quickly discovered these are tips. And then I discovered, this is not a restaurant worker. These are the tips of a stripper. And I'm not a strip club guy. I really didn't know much about that world. And outside the windows are palm trees. And very quickly, I know that I've got a single mother with a three-year-old girl working as a stripper in Florida, and I have no idea where that dream came from until I was about a month into writing it. And I realized, oh, because then I knew it was set in the fall of 2001. After that horrible day in September 2001, we all began to read those strange stories, right? Some in the Globe about these guys, these hijackers, haven't been seen in strip clubs. I mean, three of them hired a call girl the night before. Three hired a call girl at the Milford Hotel in Boston and sent her away because it was too expensive. Now, at first you think, well, why would you care at this point? But they actually sent their money back to Al-Qaeda before the horrible attack. So what I couldn't get out of my head was, and I realized what had started this, all at an unconscious level was, what would it be like to have been a woman who's danced naked for one of these men, been paid by him, and after the smoke has cleared from that terrible day, to have their blood money in your bank account. What would that be like? And, you know, 900 pages later?
Wow. You're describing a really a magical process, as far as I'm concerned, in hearing about it. And
but you must have, that must happen to you too as a journalist, though, right?
You get into a writing zone, but everything is so fact-based that it's about finding the information. It's almost a tightness, an intensity. And you're talking about something that was like, you know, just sort of open up and trust what comes. And I have to think that, I mean, and you say that 95% of your writing is, you know, I mean, what you do publish is the phoenix out of the ashes.
Right, yeah, it's a messy, disorganized way to write.
And you've obviously gotten to a point where you can trust. There must have been a time when that just must have freaked you out, and insecurity and lack of confidence. It's like that would kind of bottle you up in a way. When to the contrary, you had to find a way to just trust what's going to start coming.
Yeah, you know, I mean, you read Tony, and if you could, you don't have to. Any of you have read my memoir, but I was a. We moved 2 or 3 times a year for cheaper rent, single mom in first world poverty, blah, blah, blah. And I got beat up a lot. I was a little kid who wore glasses and used adverbs. Hey, Dubas, you want to hit off this joint? Not necessarily. Boom! You know, and, you know, I'm laughing now, but I was scared. When I look back at my, you know, we all have a story to tell, right? When I look back at my childhood, I just remember being afraid all the time. I was not ducking bullets the way far too many young people around the world in this country are, but I was ducking fists and feet and occasional knife, and I was always scared. And anyway, I became a fighter, I became a brawler, I became a boxer, and then I stopped. And writing got me away from it. And
saved your life?
It saved my life. But it's coming to me now, Dick, because one of the things I discovered writing, what I love about writing is Grace Paley. By the way, my wife says, you know, honey, you have no wisdom of your own, just like a Rolodex of other people's. I said, well, I call it attribution, damn it.
That's right.
But Grace Paley said, we write what we don't know we know. And so when I was writing Tony, I was writing about that moment right before, when you're squaring off in a fist fight. A fist fight, not a boxing match, which has rules and, you know, safety things in order, but I mean like a street fight where you could get killed. And it's a moment of great adrenaline, but there's also, I discovered something early on about it that, and it sounds almost obvious, but it wasn't to me until after the fact, and really until I was writing about fighting 30 years after having stopped fighting. And that is, it's really inappropriate. Like, you know, I don't even know this nice lady. If I went over and just gently touched your cheek, I would be violating her personal space. We all have sort of a, we should have like, we have this invisible membrane around us, which should be inviolate. Nobody's allowed in unless we allow them in. And man, are you really violating that boundary when you're trying to punch someone in the face as hard as you can, or kick him in the head as hard as you can. And I bring it up because it's a terrible connection, but stepping into the private skin of another character. I learned over the years that something larger is always at work. And I found over the years, if I just trust, if I keep moving, I'll survive this fight. If I keep moving my hand across the page, trying to find the true word, the word that captures what I'm trying to capture, not the one that makes me sound good or that Oprah's gonna like, but the one that captures the woman, the man, the boy, the girl, the dog, the alien, whatever, then it's gonna lead to something else true, and another, and another. And it's just wonderful thing. You know, I'm a monogamous guy. I'm not a faithful guy in that I don't believe in someone big up there loving me and taking care of me. But I do believe in the divine. And I do believe in mysteries, and I do believe something really beautiful is afoot. And writing the last 30 years of my life has given me faith. I mean, I'm always scared, though.
Yeah.
I never feel like writing. Tomorrow, I'm not going to feel like writing. Right now, I'm getting scared talking about it.
So, it's scary. Are you saying, though, from what you just said, are you saying that actually fighting was good preparation for writing?
In a strange, bizarre
Because you just said if
way.
You kept fighting when you became a fighter, if you kept fighting, you knew somehow you would survive it. The moment.
It taught me to step into the unknown with preparation, and and I would come out the other side.
Yeah. And so, and that's you've translated that to
the
writing life.
Yeah. Wow. It's strange.
Before I open it up to questions, I had one other question I wanted to ask you in terms of perhaps preparation is, who do you read in terms of someone you go, or someone or some persons you go back to?
Oh my God.
Do you do any kind of, because I do this, and I wonder if other writers do this. When I'm getting ready to write, to try to write something new, I have certain favorite writers. It's almost like doing calisthenics and warm-up.
Oh, that's cool. So you'll actually read them.
I'll read, and it's.
Are they nonfiction writers you admire?
Yeah, it can be a warm-up thing, and it might be I'm trying to write a lead to a magazine story, so I'll go to some of their magazine pieces, and whether I get a direct inspiration or it just puts me in the right state of mind.
Well, so first, there's that great line from Henry James that a writer is a reader who is moved to emulation. And, I know writers who don't read when they're writing their novels because they're afraid that they'll, I don't know what, that they'll be either discouraged because the novel will be really great or they'll be overly influenced. But I can't imagine not reading on a daily basis. But I read poetry every day.
Okay.
I mean, every day. I read a Kim Adonisio poem this morning. When I got to, I got off the boat here, I went to the bookstore and bought a Sharon Olds' new book. But I read poetry every day. How many of you read poetry on a regular basis? Yeah, and if you don't, you're in for a treat. Go buy any contemporary American poetry. It is so good. Can I recite you one?
Yeah.
Very short. Ted Kooser. He won the Pulitzer Prize a few years ago for a book called Shadows and Delight. It's called Starlight. All night, this soft rain from the distant past. No wonder I sometimes waken as a child. How can you not want to just write after that? So I read it every morning, man. It's like rose petals on the bed, turn the light down, put a little Luther Vandross on, get me in the mood.
How about your father? And obviously, you've read him.
Oh, yeah.
But do you go back and read him? And what are there moments when
you know, I reread him. If you don't know, you guys, so the reason I have a three on my name is I'm the son of Andre Dubuis, the great short story writer. He published 10 books in his life, seven of which were collections of short stories. And the film In the Bedroom with Tom Wilkinson and Sissy Spacek was based on his story, Killings. I teach Killings every year.
Okay.
And so I reread that every year. I teach it to kids at UMass Lowell where I teach. And one of his stories, which is called A Father's Story, is being looked at to be a film, and I reread that last winter. It was one of these great snowstorms we had last winter, and I was sitting in front of the fire in my house, and, my dad's been dead for 15 years, and he died 62 and of a heart attack and too soon, and I read this. I read the novella, his novella, and then I read the screenplay. And the screenplay wasn't nearly as good as the novella. And I went for a walk in like 3 feet of snow, and I live in the woods, and I was looking at the black tree branches and the snow coming down, and I just felt so grateful to be a son, and that he left all this art behind, and 6 screwed up kids, but he left behind some beautiful stories.
And artists.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, thanks for that. Yeah. Let's open it up. You must have some questions.
Thank you.
For Andre.
Kind lady, you look familiar. Have we met? Have we met? Yeah. No. Do you look familiar? Have we met?
No. But you said I was Marblehead.
There you go, Marblehead. I never went down there either. What's your name? Hi, Pat.
So I'm interested in having the opportunity to read about a bounty hunter. Could you actually write that, or?
What's weird? Yeah, I will. I'll repeat it. So Pat asked, she's interested in reading about having been a bounty hunter. Have I written about that? In fact, I have, and it's coming out in a magazine next month. What's weird, though, is I put it in Townie. It was part of my memoir, Townie, because I did it in my early 20s, and Townie pretty much covers being about age 8 to about 28, and then hops ahead 10 years real quick for my father's death. And I learned something very interesting writing that memoir, is that so my mother-in-law is one of my best friends. She lives with us, and and she's 93, and she read Tawny, my memoir, in manuscript, and she's talking to her sister, Cleo, down Delray Beach, Cleo, who just turned 97. So, oh, Andre's new book's an autobiography, and I was standing there. No, Mary, you know it's not. Yes, it is. I said, no, it's a memoir. I just read it. No, it's not. So she gets up. I said, Mary, she said, what's the difference? I said, I'm not sure. Let's figure it out. I said, I know what it is. An autobiography is a life story, you know, birth to death or whatever. And who cares about me, this fiction writer from Haverhill? But a memoir, you could write 10 just about being a journalist and a father. And, you could write 5 about 3 summers. So it's a piece of our lives. And what I realized in writing Tawny is that the arc that story was following was really all about, which I'd learned, by the way, writing it. This is one of the things I learned. I never thought of myself as fatherless, because I saw my father once a week, a couple hours on a Sunday. It was a real 70s kind of divorce. We never slept at his apartment, but I had a dad. He paid child support. He didn't abandon the family the way a lot of fathers do, sadly. But when I finished writing memoir, I felt emotionally that I'd been more fatherless than I'd ever admitted to myself. That if the parent doesn't live in the house and there are no phone calls, and this is way before, of course, texting and Skype and computers and emails, and there's no contact, and he's really just kind of like a fun uncle for 2 hours on a Sunday, you don't really have a dad on a regular basis. My point is, so I just kind of followed the trail, again, following it wherever it went, and I kept going, and I was working with a bounty hunter. I worked in a halfway house in Colorado, and one of my coworkers had a bounty hunting business, and I went to Mexico looking for a hitman, pretending to be gay, hanging out in gay bars, looking for a gay killer. And so, when I read it in the manuscript, it just seemed to be another story. So I just shaved it away, and it got me. You know, if you look at the word fiction, it comes from the Latin fictus or fictu, and it means to shape or fashion. And I worked really hard not to make up anything. In Tawny, and to be very factually accurate through the subjective lens of my own emotions in my memory. But so anyway, the outtake, I thought this is too damn good, so I sold it as an essay just last week. And as a matter of fact, I was editing it today before coming here. So it's going to be in a magazine called Vice, which is all about true crime and stuff like that.
I have a quick question about the memoir then, and about Tawny, if I can.
Yeah.
In writing that, and you just said you tried to be as accurate as you could, and then you shave that off for a piece of fiction. Did you read some of your father's essays to try
No.
to help you? Because there's this one, I mean, I, as a reader, a reading experience is that I'll never forget in your memoir in Tawny describing going for a run with him at those sneakers.
Yeah.
People know what I'm talking about, huh? That run. And then I was reading some of your father's essays, and he describes going for a run with you in an essay.
He does?
Yes.
I don't even remember that. No,
and I think it's the same run.
But you know,
because he's talking about.
Really?
Yes, I will find that for you.
So the memoir begins with my father was a runner, and on his birthday every year he'd go on a long. Well, he ran all the time. I had just started lifting weights, trying to change my body, my life, but I wasn't in running shape. I'd never run in my life, and I was 17 or 18, 16, I forget, and I didn't have sneakers. And, one of the big contentions in our family was my father gave, a third of his income. He expected our mother to take care of us 4 kids and rent, and she was never enough. She just never had, it wasn't enough. So I didn't have sneakers. And so I went and stole my sister's. She was sleeping late on a summer day, and I grabbed her sneakers off the bedroom floor, put them on, got in the car, and realized they were about 2 sizes too small, with the soles about, that thin, and I didn't want to tell him. So we started running, and I'm thinking, I'll just get through it. And, the first mile, I was amazed I made it a mile. And then the loop turns out to be 5.5 or so miles. So I get through it. I mean, it's agony by the third mile. I mean, my toes are all together, the heels being, everything's going wrong. And when he gets to the, when we get to the end of 5.5, and I just think I'm going to rest for a year, you ready for the next lap? I didn't realize on his birthday every year, he ran it twice for 11 miles. And I didn't want to say no to my father, and I ran 11 miles that day. And when I took the shoes off, every toe had split open, the heel had split open, and that's what he's talking about. And so, but I you know what? You're triggering a vague memory. I knew over the years, that he would, with pride, talk about my having done that, and he would actually use it as, he told a student once who was thinking about quitting writing, he used it as an analogy of not quitting. Yeah. And she wrote him a letter once, and he told me, I forgot this till just now, Dick, but he wrote her a letter, she wrote him a letter years later, and it, all it said was, Dear Andre, maybe your son should have quit. But I forgot about the essay. No, I didn't read any of those essays.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just curious.
But I'm going to go find that sucker now. Hi, what's your name?
I'm Elizabeth.
Hi.
I'm Reading County right now.
Oh, you know me a lot better than I know you.
I'm just in a 50-mile hike with bad blisters, so I feel you.
Oh, good. Cool. Oh man, that was, and what's your first name again?
Elizabeth.
So Elizabeth asked, so how was it first to tell your story and then by proxy tell their story, the, you know, your family and friends, right? Well, it was the hardest damn part. You know, I saw, I read a line years ago before I ever thought I'd write a memoir. And by the way, this memoir came, again, The Phoenix Arises from the Ashes. It rose from the ashes of an essay I was writing about my sons in baseball. And the question fueling the essay was, how come I didn't play baseball? I love baseball now. And anyway, Townie came. And the quote was, if you're going to write a memoir, you should be able to sue yourself for libel. And I love that. And I was turning 50 or so when I wrote Townie. And I felt I was far enough away from these experiences. I could be really honest about my own flaws. But I was not at all prepared to shine a light on my family. And so I wrote that first draft, sent it to my editor. She said some nice things, and she said, but didn't you grow up with people, too? I said, yeah, three siblings, a mother, you know, divorced father. But why aren't they in this book? I said, I didn't want to violate their privacy. She said, but isn't that part of your story, too? And what was I leaving out? I was leaving out that my sister was, you know, raped by two men at knife point and was selling drugs and sleeping around with boys who would never love her as a kid, that my brother was being sexually abused by a grown woman in our house on a daily basis for 6 years, that he had tried to kill himself 10 times. My younger sister was so depressed, she had a padlock, she put a padlock on her bedroom door when she was 11 or 12 years old, and just kind of left us emotionally. The house is full of drug dealers, and it was a long story. And my mother was holding on by her fingernails, you know, no family around. All her family was in Louisiana, so she had no one to help her. And my father wasn't around, and I left it all out. Richard Rousseau, the wonderful novelist, we were at a literary thing, and I knew my editor was right. And he gave me the best advice I've ever heard about this. I said, he hadn't yet written his memoir elsewhere. He said, well, if it were me, I would ask myself one thing. Am I trying to hurt anybody with this memoir? He said, and if I came to the conclusion I was, he said, I wouldn't write it, or I'd write it, but I wouldn't publish it. He said, but if I came to the conclusion, no, I'm not trying to hurt anybody. I'm just trying to remember it, capture it as honestly as I can, you know, from my subjective point of view. He said, then I'd write it. And as soon as he said that, I realized I wasn't trying to hurt anybody. I wasn't mad at anyone. I didn't feel sorry for myself. I just felt compelled to paint what it was like to grow up in a mill town in the 70s, Vietnam limping to a finish, no fathers around, sex, drugs, and all that stuff. And then my strategy was, okay, I'm only going to write about my family when their experience intersects directly with mine. So if I'm walking by my little brother's bedroom, my 14-year-old brother's bedroom at like 5 o'clock on a Thursday, and I hear the sexual moaning of a grown woman on the other side of the door, I'm gonna put in the moans, because that's part of my memoir. But the other side of the door is his memoir, and none of my damn business. And so that allowed me to write a much more honest draft, and my family's been very supportive and fine with it. You know, thank God, yeah. Thank God. Yes, hi, what's your name? Okay.
I'm just wondering if you ever struggle. Clearly, you have this incredibly empathetic soul. So, when you're writing a bad character, do you ever struggle with the fact that you will inevitably humanize them?
Oh, God, yes. How did you know? You're an empathetic character.
Well, it just seems to me it's just part of struggle in a way.
Kay, that's a really important point. So, Kay asks, you know, what if you're writing from the point of view of a really flawed person, maybe you didn't say this, but I'm reading between the lines, maybe who's doing some real evil stuff. are you ever conflicted artistically, morally, with humanizing this person? Yes. You know, in my novel, The Garden Last Day, so I'm writing from the point of view of this stripper, and I for 2 years, I got this intuitive pull from the young Saudi man in the VIP room with her. He wants the microphone. And I said, screw you. No, we know what you guys are about. You're not getting the microphone. No. And my denying him this was killing the book. So I stopped writing for 6 months. I read the Quran twice. I read 33 books about Saudi Arabia and Egypt and extremism. And I could teach a course on Islamic extremism. And then I began to write again, entering the private skin of one of these killers. These brainwashed boys is really what they are. And I teach at UMass Lowell. And every day, well, twice a week, I go to the campus. And I drive from Newburyport, down the Merrimack River in Amesbury to the highway. And I passed the home of, we lost like 60 people in those towns. And I passed the home of a guy who woke up on September 11th, 2001, hated his job. He's a salesman, young guy, real good looking athlete. His wife and he were totally in love. Little baby boy, toddler boy. She was pregnant with their second child. Something that morning, he flew like 3 times a week for his job. Something that morning made him wake his son up and say goodbye. It was like still dark out. He woke up his son, gave him a kiss, said, I love you, go back to sleep. He hugged his wife and said, after this job, this trip, I'm gonna look for a new job because I'm not seeing you guys enough. He was in the first plane that went into the first tower. And here I am trying to humanize one of his killers as I drive by and I see his wife playing with the daughter he never even met. And I'm praying for forgiveness from her, that I'm trying to make human one of the real men who killed your real husband. And so it's a huge problem. But man, I think it's the job of the writer to go to these places. If we don't, who is going to? I think we really must. You know, one of the things that I have a pet peeve about lately in the culture, in literary culture, is you'll hear a lot of discussion about, especially from editors now, I hear this with my students, they'll get rejections like, love the book, beautiful writing, my goodness, but you know, we didn't find the main character very relatable. I hate that word. What do you mean relatable? Well, we didn't find her very likable. She's got a lot of flaws. Have you read Lolita?
Yeah.
Have you read Hamlet? Have you read Helter Skelter, for Christ's sakes? Our job is to go into the madness. They're not all going to be nice. They just got to be real, right? So I prayed for forgiveness, hope I never meet her, and then I worked my ass off to make him a real person.
Wow.
Hi, what's your name?
Hi, Dee Dee.
Where did the story of House of Sand and Fog come from?
Oh, God. So Dee Dee asked, where did the story of House of Sand and Fog come from? I'll try to be very brief. I fell in love with an Iranian girl in college. And I quickly learned that you cannot date a Shiite Muslim girl from the upper classes of Tehran the way I would date a girl in Haverhill, Mass in the 70s, which is, Dee Dee, I stole a six-pack. Want to go drink it in the parking lot? It's not too warm. I'm not lying either. And so I realized that I couldn't even be alone with her. The only way I could spend time with her was to go to the apartment where her mother was like a block away, chaperoning her and her sister. And I'd had to date the whole family for like 2 years. And I fell in love with them. And I fell in love with their culture. And their father wasn't in the States yet. He was doing, I don't know what he was doing. He was not with them. And they're speaking Persian, and I'm learning baby talk Persian. They're saying, they like say my name. I look at their face to see if they're smiling or grimacing. And one day on the wall, and we're sitting at the sofre, the carpet on the floor, eating these beautiful Persian dishes, and I'm really falling in love with the family. Here's the little brother. Here's the mother. Here's the little sister. There's the girlfriend. That's as close as I ever got. And one day, there's a photograph on the wall of the Shah of Iran and a bald man, and they're smoking cigars. And I said, hey, that's the Shah. She said, yes, I know. Oh, yeah, that's your country. Hey, who's the guy with the Shah? Oh, that's Baba. Baba's Persian for daddy. Your dad knows the Shah? Oh, he worked very closely with him, and he's coming next month, and he's looking forward to meeting you. Shit! And Dee Dee, he came, and he was physically small, and I'd never met anyone like him. And I had an insight years later that growing up blue collar, I thought a strong man was physically strong. You could bench press 300 pounds and knock someone out, drive a nail with a, you know. I'd never seen real power. This guy may have weighed 130 pounds, but he talked like this, like a man accustomed to being listened to by everyone at all times. He scared the hell out of me. And it was one image that gave birth to the book, I'm sure. Much like the character of Berani in that story, that House and Fog, he's running out of money, living higher above their means, trying to marry off, frankly, my girlfriend to an upper-class Iranian. And he's working, this is in Haverhill, Mass. He's before the revolution. He's working in a shoe factory during the day for 8 hours, and then in a convenience store gas station at night. And one night around midnight, I'm there typing a paper for his younger daughter, and I help him bring groceries in. We're standing in the elevator, and he looks very tired. I thought he was ancient. He was probably like my age now. He's probably like 54 or 60. And he said in his very thick accent, he said, "Andre, I used to work with kings and queens and presidents and vice presidents and prime ministers in my office by myself. Now I serve candy and cigarettes to kids, and they don't even know who I am." And he shook his head and he said, "I never thought that would happen to me. And I never forgot it." And about 15 years later, I read in the Boston Globe, great place. I love you journalists because you give us great ideas. Yeah, it was a news brief. It was like a local brief or a national brief, a little paragraph about a woman who's evicted from her house for failure to pay back taxes. She says she didn't owe. The county evicts her anyway, repossesses the house and auctions it off. And they discover computer error, wrong house. But the man who's purchased the house in a fair and square legal auction is under no legal pressure to sell it back, and he's not sure he wants to because he's going to make a killing in the resale. And I cut that out, you know, years ago, and I went back to my story idea notebook. And that's, by the way, it's full. It's got hundreds of ideas in there. It's I don't think we'll ever run out. And I read it again, and then I saw that the man who bought the house had a Middle Eastern name. And I think it was probably Arabic and not Persian, but I immediately saw my colonel in the elevator. And then again, the curiosity, I thought, what would it be like if my Iranian colonel bought that house? And 4 years later, there's your depressing little book, you see. Should I take one or two more back here? Or?
One more.
Yeah, hi. That's a great question. What's your first name? Maggie, really beautiful, articulate question. So basically you're asking, what are the moral implications of stepping into the private skin of human beings who are not you and telling their stories? What I'm hearing you, I'm reading between the lines, but what you're really asking is, what gives you the right? Right? Yeah. And what are the consequences of that Faulknerian curiosity? It's a great question, and it's a good one to end on. The consequences are you will totally fail at it and get it totally wrong. You know, political correctness, which was, you know, this term that came about in the 80s and early 90s on campuses across the country, as you know, we all know what we mean. We don't call, you know, we know what we mean. And it is an absolutely understandable reaction to genocide, rape, murder, horrific behavior of generally white males upon brown-skinned people over the years. And I forget who the writer was, but a white male writer wrote a novel from the point of view of a Sioux, Oglala Sioux Indian. and man, was a Native American community angry. And Sherman Alexie went after him in an essay, and Rose Ellen Brown, the writer, responded, I thought, in a really beautiful way. She said, look, your outrage is absolutely justified, but look, it is not an act of colonialism or imperialism to try to imagine what it's like to be you. It's actually an act of friendship, and it's the writer's job to do it. The risk is we're going to get it totally wrong, and everyone's going to have a right to publicly hang us out to dry, and you better be able to take it, because, I mean, with the gift and honor and privilege of publishing is your chin's out there, and you better be able to take criticism over what you've wrought. But I do think that it's a great question. You know, I'm with her, is what I'm saying. I think that the act of writing fiction, and let me just get back to nonfiction real quick. This whole notion, we'll end with this. I know we're going over facts and their truth. I'm getting to know my cousins in our middle ages, because they grew up in the South and I grew up in the North. I heard two of my cousins talking about their newly dead dad, my uncle, two sisters. And I just fed them, they're drinking coffee, I'm doing the dishes, and one of them says, oh, I just don't think Daddy loved us at all. I'm going, ooh, I turn the water down. Ooh, what you gonna say to that? And I really don't remember what my other cousin said, but I began to think about my uncle. And I didn't know him well, but I knew that a little bit about his story. He'd raised five daughters as a self-employed insurance guy with his own little insurance business. He worked 80 to 100 and something hours a week. He put them all through private high school, very expensive private high school, put them all through private expensive colleges, was putting the oldest two through graduate school and medical school, and he dropped dead at 53. I'd bet this leg, my uncle would sit up in his grave if he heard that and say, honey, how can you say that? You think I did all that for me? And yet I think of my cousin. She never saw her dad at breakfast, never saw him at lunch, never saw him at supper, never saw him at bedtime, never saw him at a recital, never saw him at a game, didn't watch cartoons with him on Saturday morning. And on Sunday, the only time he took a little time for himself, he went and golfed. He was, to her, a shadow who wrote checks. Yet, she is totally 150% factually wrong that he didn't love her. But she did not feel loved. And that is the province of the memoir. And she has every right to try to capture what it was like for her emotionally, even though she's factually wrong. And I'm going to end with Tim O'Brien. Who's got a, you know, Tim O'Brien, The Things They Carried, one of the greatest living writers in America, as far as I'm concerned, who said this. He said, memory has its own story to tell. Thank you all. It was great. Thank you.
Thank you, Andre. That was terrific.